9 programmable calculator. Let's listen to what the internet has to say about it today. A mind-boggling 960 program steps, 100 memory locations, a magnetic card reader, a rich variety of built-in and solid-state functions in a program ROM module makes this beast a true geek dream machine. And as we all know, the internet, never wrong. So my father brought this wondrous device home a couple of times. And it had these magnetic cards. You could feed them in to the calculator. And he had a collection of these magnetic strips for doing astrophysics-like things, like calculating orbital trajectories or star spectrum analysis. But tucked away in the back was a game. It was a simple game where you guessed the location of a battleship by entering in coordinates, and the calculator would tell you if you were high or low. All right, not exactly Halo 3. But for me at that time, it might as well have been. But it wasn't the game that enthralled me as much as how this calculator was pulling that feat off. It was just a calculator, but it could make decisions and it could react to my choices. Now that unassuming little calculator in this odd little movie, I don't know if any of you have heard of it or not, called Star Wars, were about to change my life in ways that I could never have imagined. Now, the other thing that I feel very lucky to have experienced as a kid was Star Wars, not on VHS or DVD or free on the internet, but in the theater as a 13-year-old. Now, I grew up in a very small town. We didn't get movies until they'd been out for months. Some of my friends had seen Star Wars, and they could just not stop talking about it. Everything streaming from their 13-year-old brains was TIE Fighter and X-Wing and Luke Skywalker. I remember them showing me pictures in fan magazines of a big hairy monster and this princess with really, really stupid hair. And these silly, silly looking spaceships. Why does a spaceship need wings, I would ask. And besides, even if the wings are for flying in the atmosphere, there's no airfoil. Think about it. So after weeks of mocking them, I finally decided to go see Star Wars, see what all the fuss and ruckus was about. I was pretty sure this was going to be a complete waste of $1.75. But from the first moment that 20th Century Fox logo came on the screen, and the 10 greatest words to ever appear together faded on, a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. And the music hit me like a punch in the face, and that massive, never-ending Imperial cruiser streamed overhead. I was gone, and I was lost, and I was changed forever. Seeing that movie at that time, at that age, is an experience that is indescribable. Nothing like it had ever been seen before, and it made my 13-year-old head explode. So as I started to wonder how that calculator was able to do something as sophisticated as play a game, I was about to get my first taste of computer programming. And modifying programs to integrate polynomials didn't hold much interest for me. Still doesn't, by the way. But using that calculator to create a Star Wars game was about the most perfect thing that I could think of. Now, around this time, the Atari 2600 had just come out. And all of my friends had Atari 2600s. Now, my parents didn't want to buy an Atari 2600. I don't remember all the reasons that were given, but I'm sure it involved me shouting a lot. But what our family did eventually get was a home computer, and quite possibly the first one in the entire state of Oregon. It was a Northstar computer with a Z80 processor, an S100 bus, and 8K of RAM. It ran an operating system called CPM and was connected to a terminal. My parents sprang for an add-on graphics board called a Dazzler, and when hooked up to a TV, did 128 by 128 pixels in 16 colors. Now, armed with an obsession to program, a mind completely destroyed by Star Wars, a home computer, and no Atari 2600, I had only one choice. That was to make my own games. Now, the first video game generation had just arrived. And coin-op and video game machines were starting to appear in local pizza parlors and bowling alleys and the bars we weren't supposed to go into. But I wasn't one of the kids there, lined up with a stack of quarters, lining up to play. I was the far nerdier kid, standing around with a piece of graph paper and this futuristic digital watch that I had made out of the back of an electronics magazine. And I would copy every frame of Galaxian ships with the layouts of Donkey Kong and Centipede. And I would take careful notes in the flying time between saucers and asteroids, or count the number of enemies in each wave of Robotron. And I would take these home with me, and I would try to replicate these games on my computer. And once I'd replicated the games to perfection, at least a 15-year-old's idea of perfection, I would start to experiment. What if Pac-Man could eat through the walls? What if the ghosts could explode? I'd look at Atari 2600 games advertised in magazines, and I'd imagine what the game was like to play. And then I would try to make it. I come up with my own games, and I bring in my friends for focus testing, see what they liked or didn't like. One of my favorite things to do with my games back then was, if you lost, was to insult you and being stupid. This is not something that focus tested well with my friends, by the way. So as I entered high school, my love of programming and making games was about to collide with something else. Something which shaped my interest in games to this very day. That is storytelling. I grew up in La Grande, Oregon. It was a small town far up in the mountains, and it was impossible to get TV over the air. This was back when that was about the only way to get television. So our town was wired for cable, and a large antenna up on the mountain would feed that cable with TV. Now, since our town had cable, when HBO first came out, we were one of the first towns in the country to get it, and it was free for quite a while. I would watch every movie that came on HBO with an obsession, and I became fascinated with movies and screenplays and stories and telling stories. The games I was playing and programming stopped being arcade shooters and started to become small RPGs and adventures where there was story and plot and characters. I was starting to see games as something different, something deeper than just a challenge of reflexes, but something where you could challenge your brain with choices beyond where to jump and who to shoot first. Games for me were starting to become, and dare I say the word, artistic. Now finally, by the time I went to college, I got a brand new computer, the Commodore 64, and quite possibly the greatest computer ever made. Now, one of the things I discovered about the Commodore 64 was that you could copy all of the ROM into RAM. Now, the ROM held the basic interpreter. And I apologize if I'm getting technical here. During the second hour of the keynote, we will be discussing the 6502 instruction set in a little more detail. You laugh like I'm joking. So once it was in RAM, I found that I could modify the basic interpreter, and I created an expansion to BASIC, which I called Graphics BASIC. Now, the Commodore 64 had great graphics. There was no way to access them from BASIC without peaks or pokes or dropping into assembly language. Graphics BASIC added all new commands for doing everything from controlling sprites to playing music. Now, I was a computer science major in college, and my advisors thought I was nuts for wanting to make computer games for a living. I'm sure that there were probably secret faculty meetings, everyone shrouded in hoods to discuss the disturbed student who wants to make games for a living. So when I sold Graphics BASIC to a small game company, and they offered me a job, it didn't take long for me to quit school, pack up my car, and move to California.